Greetings and welcome to Train Signal. You're watching the Plan, Install, Configure, and Manage Transport lesson for the 70-341 exam for Exchange 2013. The specific subsection that we're going to be focusing on in this lesson is Configure and Manage Transport. So in this lesson, we're focusing on Configure and Manage Transport. This objective may include, but is not limited to, Configure edge servers, configure send-receive connectors, configure transport rules, configure accepted domains, configure email policies, and configure address rewriting. It's a lot of subjects to consider when it comes to the configuration in terms of mail flow and transport, so let's get started. The company that we're going to be looking into today is called Cake Toppers. They're makers of custom cake topper dolls, perfect for wedding cake toppers. The problem that they're having is that a family relative studying Exchange installed Exchange 2013 in their environment, and nothing works. Mail isn't flowing in or out, they need a disclaimer applied to all emails that hasn't been configured, and they have a host of other configuration needs. Now, they are a domain.local configuration. And what that means is that their domain is a .local, not a .com, on the inside Active Directory side. This is a common configuration. However, it means after the installation of Exchange, where it typically reaches out and looks at the Active Directory domain to make certain configuration choices, like the accepted domain and the way that the email address policies are configured, it means that you're going to need to make some manual configuration changes in order for mail to flow properly with a .com or a .net or a .org, whatever the actual registered DNS domain name is for the MX side of this Exchange organization. So none of those configuration changes have been made because this family relative really had no clue. Now our company is being brought in as a consultant to investigate the situation and analyze what's going to be needed and configured or reconfigured in this case. Our goal, based upon our preliminary investigation, being that Exchange is working and functioning, is to spring into action and configure some other parts of their solution while simply confirming other parts aren't misconfigured from the newbie install job. So that's our goal. Before we jump into that specifically, let's focus a little bit on the various problems that may come up with having a domain.local configuration. Okay, so let's get started. For starters, we need to discuss some of the issues that come into play with having a .local domain as your Active Directory domain. Many IT admins configure their Active Directory with a .local domain internally, and they do this with the understanding that they're configuring a security boundary by making a separation between a .local internal domain and a .com domain that's registered perhaps out on the internet. And they do this purposely to ensure a configuration boundary between their internal .local and their external .com or .net or .org. Now, when you do this, as was mentioned a moment ago, Exchange, during the installation process, it picks up on the Active Directory domain, it creates an accepted domain, it creates an email address policy, so it grabs all of that information and it utilizes that information to configure or pre-configure the Exchange environment before an administrator even touches the Exchange Admin Center. So typically that works fine if you already have your Active Directory as a .com or .net or .org, but when you're dealing with a .local, you're going to have to make some manual configuration changes here. So to have mail coming in, you have to do the following. You have to register a .com or a .net or whatever other dot extension you have for your company. It has to have a registered name on the internet. You're going to configure your external DNS with an A-host and then MX records for your Exchange server. You're going to configure an accepted authoritative domain for this .local. So you have the .local. You're going to need to configure an accepted authoritative domain using that registered.com, .net, etc. that you registered on the internet. You're going to configure an appropriate email address policy for recipients, and you can do this one recipient at a time, or you can configure the email address policy for a wide range of recipients. Then you're going to make sure the recipient connector is configured properly and that firewall port 25 is opened for your server to receive mail. So this is all part of looking over the environment for our .local organization here that we have in front of us. So this is all part of working with a .local to ensure that mail can come into the organization, and then to ensure also that the email addresses are appropriate for the various recipients within your organization. When it comes to configuring edge servers, in this case we don't necessarily have an edge server to worry about, but depending on the organization that you're working with, this may be a subject that you have to consider. So edge transport servers, they go on the perimeter of the network. That means they typically go in what they call a demilitarized zone, a DMZ, where you have a firewall on one side and a firewall on the other. So between the internet and the edge server, there's a firewall, and then between the edge server and the internal Active Directory organization with your internal Exchange servers, there's a firewall. So the edge sits in that perimeter. Now, because there is currently no Edge 2013, you will use the Edge 2010 Exchange server running Service Pack 3. The key aspects of the Edge when it comes to configuring your Edge transport servers include the following. There's the Edge subscription. This is something that you do using the Exchange Management Shell, where you create an Edge subscription, and it's an XML file that's created, and you do that on the Edge transport server. You copy that over to either a hub transport server on the inside, if it's running Exchange 2010, or a mailbox server running Exchange 2013, and you import that Edge file so that you can have this Edge subscription made between the two. Ultimately, because the Edge transport server is not a part of the Active Directory, you have to make this very specific connection or subscription between the two environments. So the Edge file is used in order to do that, that XML file. Now, after that is done, then there is a synchronization that takes place, an Edge sync, between the transport server on the internal side and this Edge transport server on the perimeter. Now, as far as configuration of that Edge server, the primary aspects of the Edge transport server role that get configured include things like transport rules, which you can configure on the internal side as well, but transport rules on the Edge transport server are essential to the flow of mail between that Edge transport server and the internet. And then you have anti-spam configuration, which is by default enabled on the Edge transport server role. This is not the case when it comes to your Exchange 2013 servers or even your Exchange 2010 servers. In both of those cases, you have to enable the anti-spam agents on the hub transport server for 2010 or the mailbox server for 2013. Now, we're going to talk about this in a future lesson as far as the anti-spam configuration, because in Exchange 2010 on the hub transport server role, you can actually manage this through the GUI. The Exchange Management Console actually gets a new piece to it that allows you to configure anti-spam settings. That's not the case with the mailbox server for Exchange 2013. So everything has to be managed through the Exchange Management Shell, which is a bit of a pain. So we'll talk about that a little later. When it comes to the Edge transport server, however, the agents are automatically installed, and you automatically have the ability to manage them through the Exchange Management Console. So you make these changes to rules, perhaps you make some configuration changes, and you think, you know what, I really like this Edge transport server. It's working just fine. Well, the other thing that you have to consider when it comes to the Edge transport service is cloning. Sometimes you want to make a duplicate of your Edge transport server. How do you do that? Well, you could just go and install another Edge transport server and make the exact same configuration changes to that server. So you make the same transport rules, you establish the same anti-spam configuration. But let's be honest, that's not only a lot of repetitive work, a repeat of something you've already done, but there's a lot of room for error there. So one of the cool things about the Edge transport service is that there are scripts that you can run that allow you to clone the Edge transport service. So we have the export edgeconfig.ps1 and the import edgeconfig.ps1. Basically, you use the first one to clone the configuration of the Edge transport server, And you use the import one to import the cloned configuration that you create using the first script. So those are the main points to keep in mind when it comes to configuring your Edge transport servers. Another important aspect when it comes to the Edge transport servers, and it may seem like we're jumping over subjects because we haven't talked about transport rules, we haven't talked about accepted domains and a few other subjects that were on the list at the beginning of our discussion here as far as subject matter that we need to consider. Well, that's because we're going to take a look at our Exchange environment and we're going to look at the configuration of a lot of those points directly. But there are certain things that are still conceptual, and so one of the conceptual discussions that we're going to have involves address rewriting. Now, ultimately, you use address rewriting to present a consistent appearance to external recipients. So essentially, address rewriting is the process of rewriting email addresses for all outgoing messages. Now, what's interesting is we just discussed the .local point of view where you might have a .local on the inside, the Active Directory side, but you want email to go out as .com or .net or whatever you've registered for your domain name. So you can actually use email address policies to handle that. But there are other times when you may want to make a configuration change on the Edge transport server itself in order to ensure that all email that leaves an organization actually leaves with the proper SMTP address space that you've configured. Now, one thing to note is that this is done on the Edge transport server, and you use the Exchange Management Shell to modify this on an Exchange Edge transport server running 2010 Service Pack 3. Some of the reasons why you might need to do this instead of using an email address policy is, let's say you have a group or company merger or an acquisition. Perhaps you have a partnership that takes place, and so for a period of time, you might have mail that is leaving your organization and perhaps leaving the partnership organization that requires it to have a change to the SMTP address space. So on the internal side, email is working the same, but when it leaves the company, it's either going to take the name of the new company or it's going to have to take the name of, let's say, a new name that has been established by both companies. So it really depends on the type of merger. In some cases, two companies merge together, like United Airlines and Continental Airlines, and perhaps they come up with a whole new name, or perhaps they stick with one of the two company names, depending on which one is the stronger company, or depending on which company did the buying. So for a time, however, you might still want persons to be able to use the continental.com email address, but other times you might want to merge it in, and so that all emails that leave the organization, they leave with this different united.com email address. So it's just something to consider. It's a little different from the email address policies that we talked about a little bit earlier. Now, you use the Exchange Management Shell to configure address rewriting. You use the Get Address Rewrite Entry in order to see the entries, and you use the Set-Address Rewrite Entry in order to set the entry so that you say any email coming from this domain is now going to go out with this domain as its SMTP at the end. So basically, there are agents that handle this on the Edge transport server. So the address rewriting inbound agent works with the address rewriting outbound agent, and both of these have to be enabled in order for these entries to be applied to email messages that will either enter or leave the Edge transport service. In the case of our scenario, we're not working with an Edge transport server, so we're not really worried about any of these aspects when it comes to transport, but we do need to cover this material. You never know when you're going to see this type of discussion on the Exchange 70-341 exam, and so it's important that we cover all topics that are going to be brought up perhaps on the exam. As far as it being brought into our scenario, it's not necessarily part of the scenario, and so we're not going to do any manual configuration of the Edge transport server to configure address rewriting and so forth. However, there are some hands-on configuration aspects that we do need to consider, and so let's look at our scenario again in terms of what we're going to look at on the servers that we have set up. So in the case of this scenario, we need to hunt, fix, configure, or reconfigure what has been done. So when you come into a scenario where things have been configured by another team or another individual, that can be quite frustrating. So you need to prepare ahead of time, and that can save you time when you're actually on site, And it also makes for a great impression with a client. I can recall in one case where I walked into an office and they said, "Oh, we're so glad you're here. We have a problem with transport rules. We needed a disclaimer set up for our organization. And the company that came in and set up all of our servers, they did not set up our disclaimer. Can you fix this?" And so because I knew exactly where to go, I was able to open things up in the Exchange Management Console. This was at Exchange 2007 at the time. And I was able to navigate quickly to where I needed to go to make transport rule adjustments. I was able to make the rule quickly. They saw that. They were impressed. This can really go a long way. So when you're called into a situation like this where you need to hunt, fix, configure, or reconfigure, it's good to know where the important settings are. You don't want to hunt for them in front of the client. It's good to know the fixes that should be put into place. So it's good to know some of the common mistakes that folks make, especially newbies, so that you can walk right in and go, "Yep, I think I know where there might be a problem here." And then it's easy for you to navigate and find out if the newbie really knew what they were doing or if they just sort of installed it and then kind of got stuck. That happens. So you can go in there and you'll know which fixes should be put in place. You need to know how to configure the pieces that are missing. So sometimes send connectors are missing. That's why mail isn't flowing. Sometimes the accepted domain is not configured. Sometimes the email address policy isn't configured. Sometimes anonymous access is not established on the receive connector. Sometimes mail isn't flowing into the organization because the person didn't know how to configure the MX records on the DNS side for the external DNS server. So there are a lot of reasons why mail might not be flowing. And anyone who has worked for a slight period of time in the Exchange world typically has a list of things in their head as far as what to look for. So we're going to discuss some of these things now in terms of transport. And then, of course, you have to reconfigure, which at times means deleting and replacing pieces that are misconfigured. Okay, so that's what we need to do here in this case. We need to prepare ahead of time before going in and sitting and talking with this client. So let's jump over to our Exchange servers that are set up here in the lab. Let's take a look at some of the different transport settings, whether it's transport rules or accepted domains or email address policies. Let's take a look at these. And so let's talk about what we need to look for when we're actually on site. All right, so here we are on our Windows server running 2012. We already have the Exchange Admin Center up and running. And it's good to note the structure of our lab setup at this point, because it's important when you're working with a company, like in our case, we're working with Exchange Exchange, which is set up as a consultancy. And in our case, we're going to see a lot of different clients come our way. So there are different problems that different clients might have, and we can help them in different ways. One way is by showing them in our lab environment how certain things should be configured so that they can go back to their environment and configure it that way internally. Another way is to work through what our environment is doing and then compare it to what their environment has so that we can see where there might be a problem. We can also utilize the lab setup that we have in order to test out different ideas and see what happens. So there are a lot of different positive reasons for having a lab setup, whether you're working in an Exchange environment currently or studying this at home. Now in our situation here, we have three servers set up. We have two mailbox servers, and these are not running the client access server role. And then we have a separate server running the client access role. Now, this is important because when it comes to accessing your Exchange Admin Center, if you're used to installing both of these together, and let's say you only have one server and you install them together, you might not realize that in order to access the Exchange Admin Center, you actually have to go through the client access server. So this server role is the one that actually holds on to all of the web-based console pages and so forth that you're looking to access. So keep that in mind when you type in the URL up at the top. And then you're looking for the ECP, which stands for Exchange Control Panel. This is a throwback to Exchange 2010. I'm not exactly sure why they didn't remember to change this to EAC, but they'll probably get to it in the next version of things. And so that brings us to the Exchange Admin Center. Now, by having a setup like this, it gives us the ability to perform a variety of different tests within our environment. Now, in this case, when it comes to the company we're working with today, the mail flow feature is actually the one that we want to focus on. So you can see here under mail flow, it has all of the different pieces that we need to focus on. Transport rules, accepted domains, email address policies, and then we have the send and receive connectors. So to start with, let's take a look at accepted domains. You can see that when we installed Exchange, it automatically reached out, tapped Active Directory, and said, okay, the domain here is exchangeexchange.com. And so it automatically configured this accepted domain for our organization, and it also set it as an authoritative domain type, as opposed to an internal or external relay type. Great. Well, if our internal domain name matched the name that we use externally with an external DNS server with MX records to point off to our servers here, then that would be wonderful. But in this case, we are working with a company that used an internal .local Active Directory. And so what they would see here is their company name .local. Well, obviously that's going to be a problem. It's a problem because that's not going to allow for external email to come inside, because folks normally email a .com, a .net, a .org. They don't email a .local. At the same time, the other problem is that the email address policy will automatically be set up as well, as you can see here, and so the primary domain would be at companyname.local. So this is probably one of the problems that the company we're working with would have for their environment. They had a newbie set up their Exchange environment. They're working with a .local. The person who set it up probably has no real concept of accepted domains or email address policies. So we're going to have to look for that first thing. When we get to their environment, we would look to see how is the domain set up for Mailflow and what is the email address policy. Now, we talked about address rewriting. Again, if this was a situation where we were dealing with multiple forests and we wanted to provide some kind of consistent email address, we would need to then rename the addresses from whatever's going on internally, send it through an Edge Transport server. The Edge Transport server would have agents for inbound and outbound address rewriting. And so we could do that. We could make it so that companies that merge together could provide for a unified name for their email. And we could do it in that way. In this case, it's a little different. We do have a .local on the inside. We are going to make some changes here in order to establish a new naming email address policy. But this is done right from within the Exchange organization. We don't necessarily need to set up an Exchange Edge Transport server in order to make these changes. So for starters, we can't really change the email address policy until we establish a new accepted domain. So in the case of the .local, the first thing we would do is register a .com or .net or .org out on the internet. And then, of course, we would have to make sure we have an MX record configured and pointing off to the Exchange environment. Now, that could go through some type of service for archiving or anti-spam or antivirus and so forth, or it can come directly in. It just depends on the environment itself. But ultimately, whatever domain we configure for our external email, whether it's a .com, a .net, a .org, we're going to pretty much have to establish that as a new accepted domain for our Exchange environment. So here in this case, we see we can give it any name we want. Why don't we just call it Contoso? And the reason for that is because when we click the next box, you can see that's the example that's provided, that we can specify an SMTP domain or domains with subdomains. We can use contoso.com, we can use star.contoso.com. So being that this is just a demonstration, in order for us to get our bearings for our client, we're going to just stick with the default Contoso here. And you can see that we can make it an authoritative domain, an internal relay domain, or an external relay domain. So at this point, hopefully you already know what these different types of domains are, as far as email coming in and being delivered to a recipient in this Exchange organization, or relayed to an email server outside this organization. So depending on the configuration, you would determine what you would choose. In our case, of course, we want an authoritative domain, and we click Save. All right, so now we have two of these different domains. We don't necessarily need the second one, but we're going to leave it alone here for now. We don't want to make too many changes for the sake of the demonstration. We go up to email address policies. And so the nice thing is we have this policy already here, and we can configure this. But if we just click the plus sign, we can create a new policy, we can establish a new email address format, and you can see here that it asks us to select an accepted domain. Now, obviously, if we did not set up a new accepted domain, we would have no other options here, but being that we did set up Contoso, we can actually establish Contoso here. In addition, we can configure the way that email addresses should be established for our end users. We can look at more options. And ultimately, we can create this new email address format. And then we can apply it down to our recipients. So here you can see we have the ability to apply this to different recipients. We can create rules to further define the recipients that this email address policy applies to. So if you already had a grouping of users, and let's say you have already given them an email address and so forth, but now you want to change it, you can actually make the changes and enforce it across the recipients that you choose. So you can see in this case all recipient types, or you can narrow down the recipient types you're looking for. So there's quite a bit of flexibility here. So that's the first thing that we would look for in this case. We would look for the accepted domain configuration and the email address policy configuration. At the same time, we would also make sure that the DNS side is configured properly on the external DNS. Now, another thing that we talked about is the ability to send out emails with a disclaimer attached. So switching gears here, if we look over to rules, we currently have no rules established. So we want to establish this disclaimer. Now, we could click the plus sign and we can create a new rule. You recall with transport rules, we basically need a condition or conditions, an action or actions, and then this is optional, but we can also have exceptions. So every rule might have an exception, but that's optional. Now, we can do this by just clicking the plus sign here, but if you notice, if we click the little triangle to the right, it gives us a few basic templates to start with. And so, obviously, applying disclaimers is something that's done often, and so you can see it's right up here at the top. Now, clicking this is not really going to solve all of our problems. It's going to pretty much just put us on the path by having the append the disclaimer action already here in the box. So if we did this all manually, you can see that's the only piece that was actually filled in. We can always just go in and do this ourselves. All right, now we're going to give this a name. We'll call it disclaimer. And then we have to establish the condition. So in this case, we're going to establish this that if the recipient is located, let's say, outside the organization, because if it's an internal email, you don't necessarily need the disclaimer, let's say. That's not a concern of yours. So only if it goes outside the organization, we say OK. Then a disclaimer will be appended to the email. Now, we need to provide the text for this. And of course, there's more official text than this, but you would have your company text put in here. You can actually adjust it, make it just right for the circumstances and the emails and so forth. And then you can determine a fallback action if the disclaimer cannot be applied. You can wrap it, ignore it, or reject it. And there we go. We click Save. And so now we have this disclaimer that can be applied to the end of emails for all outgoing email messages. So this is just one of those things that the client has asked about, and you can see how easy it is for us to configure that. The bigger problem is the sending and receiving of email. So we worried about the DNS side on the external side. We made sure that there's a .com registered or a .net or .org. We made sure that the accepted domain and email address policies match up. But of course, the next part of the process is the send and receive connectors. So just looking at the receive connectors to start with, you can see that there are a lot of different types of connectors, actually. So this is for our mailbox server, MB1. There are two connectors that are here. Here's the MB2 server, again, two connectors. And we have the client access server, which, as you can see, has three connectors. So one of the concerns here is to make sure that the connector that you have established for receiving mail from the outside world has anonymous connectivity established on it. So if we just look at the various connectors here, the default front end, let's say, and we go to security, we can see that it's established with anonymous users here. That's one of the reasons why email might not come in, is if this was accidentally not checked on the connector that's coming in, not just from the outside world, the internet, into your organization, but depending on how you have this configured, you need to make sure the security is proper if you're setting up connectors between your organization and another. Let's say you have a partner organization and you establish various security settings like TLS or mutual TLS. So making sure that you're in sync in terms of the security is also essential. But you'll notice something interesting, and that is if we go to the send connectors, there are no send connectors. So when we go to the client and we look at the various settings here, if we go to the send connectors and there's nothing here, well, that would be a good reason why mail would not be flowing outside of the organization. People can email each other without a send connector here. There's invisible send connectors that make sure that you can send email back and forth. People can email each other within the organization, but they cannot send mail to the outside world if there's no send connector. So, if we look at this, we can click the plus sign, and now we can just call this Internet. And you can see how here we can actually establish a couple of different types of connectors. So we can establish a connector for non-Exchange servers, a foreign connector. We can establish an internal connector. We can establish an intranet connector. So internal would be for intranet mail. Remember, we talked about different types of accepted domains, and so we can establish different connector types there. Internet is where we're sending email to the internet directly, so we'll actually set this one up. And note partner, for example, route mail to trusted third-party servers. So again, this is when you have, let's say, a situation where you're partnered up with someone and you might want to have specific security settings between you and your partner in order to ensure email between the two of you is more secure than just going through the internet itself. All right, so we've chosen internet. We click next. Now, as far as how mail will route properly to the internet, there are two different options. You can use an MX record associated with recipient domain. This is usually the easiest way to send email. However, the problem is that if you're setting up a lab environment and you're trying to just get this to work through a lab environment, the MX record may not work in that email may bounce back due to anti-spam or antivirus settings on the receiving Exchange server. And that mostly has to do with the settings from your ISP. If you're configured as, let's say, a home or small office user and they're giving you a dynamic IP address, well, the other servers can detect that, and so they kick back your email because they think that this is just a spam server that's just been set up temporarily to throw out as much spam as possible until it gets closed down. So at that point, the MX record is not going to work well. Your other option is to go through a trusted smart host. Now, you can actually pay for this smart host to assist, but if you're just doing testing, you can typically find a free smart host that will allow you to have a little bit of email sent through them for the sake of testing. So, depending on the information that comes back, you might set up the MX record one, or you might go with routing through smart hosts. In our case, we'll just choose the MX record, click next. As far as the address space, in this case, because we want all email, other than email that's going specifically to a partner or specifically through the intranet settings that we might have and so forth. In this case, we want all email sent out to the internet, so we're just going to use the asterisk wildcard in order to accomplish that. We click Save. Next, we need to establish the send connector with a specific server containing transport roles, so we can establish it with one or two servers. In this case, we'll establish it with both servers. Click Add. So both of our mailbox servers have this connector established for them. We click Finish, and we're all set. Notice that the maximum message size is 10 megabytes. We can change this as well. We can double-click to go into the properties, and you can see that we can make some changes. The maximum message size is here. We can change that. We can look at the delivery. We can make some configuration changes here. Scoping. So there are options there as well. And you can see if we click the three dots here, it takes us to organization transport settings. And if we select that, It's a little bit different as far as now we can change the receive message size, the maximum message size, the number of recipients. You might recall in a previous lesson we discussed SafetyNet and how it has a hold time of 2 days, so we can make some adjustments there. The maximum retention time is 7, so this is where you would accomplish that. Here's delivery. You can see DSN codes and so forth. So obviously, by going through the different settings ahead of time, before we visit the client, it makes it so much easier for us in terms of knowing exactly what to look for, knowing exactly where to configure certain things, knowing exactly where to find the configuration settings for certain things, and knowing exactly what types of configuration procedures really should be in our mind before we set foot on the property of the client. Because one thing clients love to do is look over your shoulder as you're configuring things. So it's good for you not to be clicking around going, I know this is somewhere, I know I had this in my head. No, you don't want to do that. You want to know exactly where you're going in order to show that you're a master of this. You're more than just proficient, but there's a good reason why they're paying you the big bucks. There's a good reason why they've pulled you in to do this job. All right, so obviously that requires more than just clicking around. It requires some intense reading at times. All right, and so spending some time investigating the different features and so forth under the mail flow feature and knowing what all of these different settings can and cannot do is very helpful for us. There may be more that you would like to learn on this subject. So let's jump back over to our slides and let's review some of the additional information that's available. To learn more about the subjects that were discussed in this lesson, I recommend that you take some time to visit TechNet and look at some of the articles that are listed here, including accepted domains, email address policies, understanding address rewriting, and view or configure an address rewrite entry. Now, you'll note with the last two, and you can kind of see this by just looking at the end of the URL, it says v equals exchg, so exchange, .150. And you can see the top two say 150, the bottom two TechNet references say 141. And so the reason for this is because the top two are dealing with Exchange 2013, the bottom two are dealing with Exchange 2010. Now the reason for this is because the bottom two are dealing with the Edge Transport Server role. Remember we talked about this with address rewriting, that it would go through the Edge Transport Server role, and as you know, we do not have an Exchange 2013 Edge Transport Server. So that's why those two bottom TechNet articles relate back to Exchange 2010. So we hope you found this informative. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next lesson.